Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for iOS Today is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
It's moving day. It's almost moving day. We're moving. If you're moving, we can help you with apps.
Plus, a new app that brings an old game back to life.
And someday all your wishes and your wishes will come true. We also have an app for that.
Oh, it's time for iOS Today. I love that show. iOS Today is brought to you by FrameBridge, the fast, easy, affordable way to frame the things you love. Visit FrameBridge.com and use the promo code iOS for 15% off your first order. And by Blue Apron. Blue Apron will send you fresh, high-quality ingredients to cook delicious meals with simple step-by-step instructions right to your door. See what's on the menu this week and get your first three meals free with free shipping by going to blueapron.com/twit. And by The Tracker. Tracker makes losing things a thing of the past. Pair Tracker to your smartphone and attach it to any item and find its precise location with the tap of a button. Visit thetracker.com right now and enter promo code iOS today for 30% off your entire order. Welcome, 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 iOS Today.
Mm-hmm. The show where we talk about iPhones, iPads, Apple Watches, Apple TVs, and anything else that comes out.
And the last show that we're going to do from the Brick House. We have other shows following, but this is our last iOS Today.
Yep.
And that's why we're sitting in an unusual situation. They've already torn down our set, and it's gone. So we're just kind of here. Pretty soon this will be a card table. And we'll be holding these microphones up with coat hangers, and we'll be lit with just one single work lamp from Sears with a bulb in it. That's the next step in iOS Today. Everything will come back.
We have a new studio, brand new. It's going to be wonderful.
It's going to be great.
And but maybe you're moving too. Maybe you're going to college. Maybe you're moving across town, across the country, across the world, and moving in with someone else. Who knows?
Moving is hard.
It is. It's stressful.
And I was talking to somebody on the radio show on the weekend, and she said, every time I move, I say, this will be my last move. And I always say that. I say, they're going to take me out of here in a pine box. I was hoping they would take me out of here in a pine box, but they refused to.
We could do that.
So
I'm happy to do that. I'm happy to take you out of
the
pine
box. And yet, after you're in somewhere for 4 or 5 years, don't you kind of get the itch?
Mm-hmm.
Maybe it's just me, but the itch, like, I think it's time for somewhere new, and it's fun to move because you get a new start. If you do it right, you get rid of all the old stuff. You only save the stuff you really love. The worst kind of move is where you just throw everything in a box, and then it's in your garage for 4 years.
Yeah, you don't want to do that.
Don't want to do that.
No.
Do we have an app for that?
We have all kinds of apps for that. Yes. So I put this out on Twitter and asked what you thought. I got some responses. Ralph Weeks said that he has used the Numbers app.
Numbers, that's the spreadsheet app.
Yep, and he also recommends Airtable, which is a database app, which we've talked about before, but I had not thought about this for the move. So the Numbers app is just, it's just a spreadsheet. I think you have to download it on your iPad. It doesn't come with it.
But they give you a little thing that says, they remind you, I think, you haven't downloaded the free apps. Would you like them? When you buy a new iPad or iPhone and it offers you, would you like to download all of the Apple apps? I would just download them all.
Do you use Numbers?
I do. Numbers is, the king of the spreadsheets is Excel. And I'm old enough that I used its predecessors, VisiCalc, believe it or not, on Apple II and Lotus 1-2-3 on the IBM PC. Excel is like what all the serious number crunchers use. But when Apple came out with Pages, they focused on, it does the number crunching. It does, you can do financials in it and stuff. But they focused on presentation and making something that could make beautiful graphs, beautiful, pages with the contents in it. And I think that was a smart move because the truth is a spreadsheet, a numeric calculating spreadsheet, is a pretty straightforward thing now. If you need some very advanced features like pivot tables, you probably use Excel. But for most of us, if we're doing a home budget, or in his case, he's using it kind of like a database, which is a table of information. Pages is really a very good choice. You could embed pictures of your stuff
mm-hmm.
along with the serial number and information about location and you know, when you got it, when you're getting rid of it.
There's a mortgage calculator in there. So if you're moving and you're looking to buy a house, it's already in there. And you can, you know, just add the...
But see how nice that looks compared to an Excel spreadsheet, which would just, you know, have those numbers at the bottom. I think that's really nice.
And you can just add, you know, if I want to buy a $8 million house.
What are the monthly payments on an $8 million house? I guess you have to put in the interest
rate. That's $900 million. 10% down payment, easy, 4.2%.
Interest rate, APR,
payment with principal, $5,000.
A month.
As long as you're willing to put $90,000.
10% is nothing. $9 million.
$900.
What's 10% of $9 million? $900,000. Thank you.
Yeah.
That's why we have spreadsheets, ladies and gentlemen. Because we can't do basic arithmetic.
So, yeah, that's all there. You can make your own, too. There's all kinds of personal budget. Maybe you need a budget for the move charts. If you're comfortable with the basic spreadsheets and you want something pretty and basic.
The real forte of numbers is presentation.
Yes.
You got to make a chart for the boss. That's the way to do it.
And then Airtable, we talked about this a little while ago.
I don't remember that. It's like a freeform database.
It's a database, yeah. And it is also pretty. So you can, they have some standard ones in here. You can make one for moving. So then you can put, what's your furniture? You can take pictures and add that. You can add, you know, people that are helping you move, moving companies. And then, you know, I haven't moved in a while, but I have been using this for my car purchase, which is nice because you can link to different, like I have.
You're doing a lot of research.
Yeah, doing a lot of research. So I can link, like I have a dealer, there's the dealer, and I can link all the cars that are at that dealer. And that's really nice because then you can look by dealer or you can look by car. And that's...
This is basically a database. And if it's a database you want, there's a company called FileMaker that was spun out of Apple. FileMaker really makes great databases. They offer for free FileMaker Go, which has custom apps. They call them apps, but it's really a front end to a database. You can do it on your desktop computer. That's not a free program. Get FileMaker for your desktop computer. And then have FileMaker Go keep the information. And I think that's actually kind of what you'd want to do. Here's an asset database, for instance. This is all free, and you could easily do the kinds of things that you're talking about where you'd keep information, maybe have a picture of your dresser and information about it. But it also has a much more powerful front end that you can run on the desktop on Windows or Macintosh. So I think FileMaker, a friend of mine asked me the other day, he said, I have a friend who's an art collector, and she has an old database. She had a FoxPro database, like a really old database of all the artworks she had, and she wanted to modernize it. What should she do? And I said, absolutely, the power tool on Macintosh and iPad is FileMaker. They used to make, somebody in the chat room saying, oh, I miss Bento. Yeah, Scooter X misses Bento. Bento was their free kind of simple database for the iPad. That's gone. I don't know why. It was an AppCap many moons ago. But FileMaker Go is still around and still a great app.
Well, Sortly is another app that's designed. Have you ever used Sortly?
No.
Sortly is just something for people who really want to organize their stuff. So you might not even need to be moving, but you just want to organize the stuff in your house or organize the stuff at your work. Or it has this moving section too, which is great. So you can, create an outline. Where is this? Okay, you can add photos of what you're deciding to move. So I want to move this table, so I'm going to take a picture of that and save that. So that's there. And you can add an icon. Let's see, where's the furniture icon for this? Sortly. That looks like a chair. Do you think that's a chair? I don't know what that is. That looks like that.
It has... mystery icons.
You
can take a picture of it.
Yes. Oh.
Let's not forget that wire when we move. Do we have
exactly.
A wire icon?
So here's all your, it basically covers, I guess that's your furniture icon. There's a lot of different furniture icons. Your safe, your technology, your shoes. Of course, you want to move all your shoes, your hats, your glasses. So you just put all the items in there. It also has a moving checklist. Let's see, where is that moving checklist? Moving checklist.
Oh, that would be handy.
Yes.
Yeah.
I know it's somewhere. Moving checklist. There we go. So it goes by like 8 weeks before. So you want to start early. 8 weeks before, you sort and clean, make a file, manage your school records, investigate moving options. And 6 weeks before, 4 weeks before, what are we in the move? A week before?
Yeah.
We got to pack our suitcases and manage our prescriptions.
Yes. John, managing my prescription. Can I get some more Xanax, please?
We forgot to take the day off 2 weeks before and ready our vehicle.
Is that what it says? Take the day off?
A few days before, we got to defrost the freezer. Let's not forget.
Did we defrost the freezer yet?
Are we bringing the freezer?
Yeah, I think so. We have a kitchen. I think we need a freezer.
So this is for someone who loves organizing stuff. But it's nice that there's the checklist there. Sortly is free, by the way.
The last time I moved, one of the issues for me, and this might be an issue for you too, is getting how am I going to put the furniture in the new place? Mm. And for that, I wanted to make a floor plan. Now, I used an app called Magic Plan, and it's really a powerful app. What's nice is it's free to start with. So first of all, you say, what trade are you working in? Renovation, real estate, personal use, claim, restoration. So you see, it really has a lot of applications, architecture, inspection. But in this case, it was just personal use. So I'm going to turn that on. And yeah, I can create a new plan. I wanted to create a new a plan for my studio. Now, this is really cool. You could take a picture of it, or you can draw it, or you can import an existing plan and draw over it. Once you have a plan in here, you can add your furniture, and you can actually add your furniture in its actual dimensions and then move it around. Can the bed go here? Is there enough room to walk around the furniture there? I found this really handy. Now, this is called Magic Plan. It's free, but when it's time to print the plan, to create a plan as a PDF or print it on your printer, you pay for it. It's $2.99 per plan. You can buy 10 plans. So this is nice because you can do it all on your, you can even geolocate this. You could do it all on your iPad for free. And if you don't need to print the plan, no big deal. You can have it on your iPad. But if you want to print it, they charge a little bit. This is another one that I played with that I really like. It's called Room Scan. And unfortunately, I'm not going to be able to really demonstrate it because the idea is, and this worked really well, how do you get the dimensions of your room in there? You scan the room with Room Scan using your iPhone. So what you do is you run the you press the phone against the wall until you hear a beep, and then you continue and you continue, and you will get the dimensions, and it's really accurate of your room. Really, for our purposes, it's not like we're going to use this for building plans. We're just going to use this to try to figure out, you know, where to put the bed, where to put the sofa. But this is really I think a very helpful thing to get the room plan into your iPad and take this to dinner with your honey or your spouse or your future roommate and be able to move furniture around and so forth is really a handy thing. Look at that. They're actually laying out the floor plan. You're also looking for something that will have built-in furniture templates, refrigerator. There's certain standard size for refrigerators and stoves and all of that. So having those items and placing them in there really helps you lay out your room. I love these ideas. So these are two different programs. You can download both. I think Room Scan is $4.99 to download the pro version. Magic Plan is free to download and mess around with. You only pay as you go, and you want to print stuff out. It's pretty cool. You can get statistics about all the surface areas. You can estimate construction. Lots of nice features to these. This is really, an iPad is really well designed for this kind of purpose, I think. It's perfect, especially an iPad Pro. If you had a big screen and a stylus, you could do even more.
Yeah, I feel like there are AR apps that can do that, too.
That you could fly through them, yeah.
Maybe they're just Google apps where you're holding your iPad and you're looking at the couch. Where's the couch going to go?
Google has this platform called Tango that is designed to do that. And there's a kind of ugly tablet. I mean, especially if you're an iPad user, you look at that and go, no one would want that. It looks like something you'd use in the military or something. It's like real, got bulky bulbs and stuff. And they've released a Tango phone, and I think there are plans to do more. But that's such a special purpose that you wouldn't do all the time. I don't know why you would buy a special device for it. Mm-hmm. Your iPad with its own camera can do most of what you want to do to map out a room. And it doesn't need to be perfect. It just needs to give you the rough dimensions. I mean, we used to do it on the back of a napkin, right? I'm sure you've done that.
Yeah.
So where are we going to put the couch? You know, where's the TV? For me, it's all about where's the TV going to go?
Exactly. Or that's how you get exercise, by moving it yourself.
Okay, and that's maybe okay, also how you get maybe that's sometimes. Yes, maybe that's because as a husband, I've been compelled to move and rearrange rooms multiple times in a short period of time. Can you put that couch over there? Let me see how that looks. And you're right. That is not, this is something you would like to do on the iPad first.
Well, as long as I'm just sitting there saying, move it there, move it there, move it there.
Oh, no, I make sure. Okay, you take one end.
I don't think I need an app for that. It's fine. I'm very good at that. It doesn't take any exercise.
Yeah, let's try that.
Well, Patrick Delahanty recommended he used an app called Glimpse during his move. He was moving here to work here from cross country, and he used Glimpse. He said everybody here could watch him travel from the East Coast to here. So that is something, if you're trying to get there at a certain time, you can use Glimpse. You share your real-time location with friends. It gives you a little more access to who you're sharing with and who you're not sharing with than, say, you know, just Find My Friends does on the iPhone, which I feel like you turn that on and it's on forever.
Glimpse is great. I've used that many times to say I'm on my way. And if you're using an Uber or a Lyft or some of these other apps, they often have that feature. Uber has a feature built in where you're on your way and you're getting there and you just press a button in the Uber and it'll send them a text that says, click this link and this is where Johnny Jet is and why he's late for dinner.
Was he late for dinner the other night?
Ever happened.
You can do that in Waze too, send your location too. But Glimpse is an app. And I think Glimpse has some that work directly with your car navigation also. Glimpse Auto. I'm not sure if that's the
built into Waze. Now, here's one issue that happens all the time when you've got a new place. Let me take a picture. Let's see of this studio wall here. Okay, there you go. There's the studio wall. Now, the studio wall is kind of gray, kind of ugly, but I would like to know what it would look like if I had a different color of paint on the wall. Okay, so let me try this. There are a number of programs that will let you do this. Actually, I'm going to go back and pick a, let's see. By the way, this is a free one, and you can see I'm getting ads in it. But you know what? Free is always a good idea. Let's see. Fill the area with, there you go. That's a little bit better than the gray, don't you think? I love these programs that will let us paint a wall before we actually have to apply any paint. One of the problems with the little tiny swatches of paint, you know, the paint chips that you get at the paint store, they're too small. They're actually literally too small for your eye to see what it looks like. So if you've ever bought a paint based on the color of the paint chip and then painted it on the wall, and that's not at all what it looked like. That's because it's too small. It has something to do with your fovea, and I can't remember all the technical terms. But this is important if you're going to use paint, to see it big. And so there are a number of augmented reality programs. This is one of them called Painter that will let you paint the wall with a variety of paints. Even Sherwin Williams, this is called Paint Tester, I should say. There's one from Sherwin Williams, I think, or one of the paint companies that will let you actually, for $2.99, you get the advertising free version, let you actually use Sherwin Williams paint colors, and then you can just go down to the store and say, I need 39, 64, 43. There are lots of companies that make these. And I think this is a really great use. It is augmented reality, but instead of having a Pikachu on your wall, you're seeing what your room would like if we're painted purple.
You could put a Pikachu on your wall, too. That might be nice.
You could also do that.
You wouldn't have to go anywhere. Yeah. You just have Pokemon
paint
right there.
Paint Tester from Luminant Software. There's a free version, which you probably should try before you buy. And for $2.99, you can get the ad-free pro version.
Well, before you move, you also want to organize your stuff. A couple months ago, we talked about the KonMari method.
You've used the KonMari.
Yes. You take every item in, let's say, your closet. You take it all out, put it in a giant pile, touch, hold everything, decide, does it spark joy or not? And then if it does not spark joy, you give it away. Or you throw it away.
Right.
Depending on what you do.
So that's why you have all of my wife's clothes.
Yes, lots of stuff didn't spark joy, and now it's all...
Now it's not sparking joy in your house.
That's why I didn't go and get it out of your closet when I was over there the other day.
Can I just point out, KonMari even mentions that. She says, when you do the KonMari process, make sure no one else is there with you. Mm-hmm. Because A, they'll either start taking your stuff, creating a problem for themselves, or B, they'll say, oh, good, now that you have all this room, let me give you some of my crap. So she talks about this in the book.
Yeah, she talks about also, like, don't have your mom there, or right. if it's your child, don't be there, because you will have attachment to, you know, your children's things. Other than a different attachment they will have.
I'll never forget trying to get rid of all of the primary colored plastic crap that our children had accumulated over the first few years of their lives. And we put it all in a big pile for the guy, the garbage man, to come and get. And the kids found it. And it all found its way back into their room. So you can't throw out that. I love that. Wait a minute. I haven't seen that. And it all ended up back in the room. So never let your kids see you do this.
Some of that stuff also ended up with us, too. We got a lot of your kids.
Yeah, I know you did.
I'm basically just living your life. It's not creepy at all.
I'm not coming over, though. I think I can handle that. Yeah. If you have pictures of me on your wall, I'm really going to be freaked out.
So KonMari now has an app.
Oh, you know, we've been waiting for this.
We have been waiting.
We talked about this.
It doesn't look so great on it doesn't work so well on the iPad.
But it's an iPhone app.
It's an iPhone-only app. So let's...
put the iPhone over
there. Let's put the iPhone right there. Yeah. So there...
Ooh, what is that stand you're using? That's a nice stand.
This is...
just some old stand.
Ilago. Ilago.
Ilago. Push it farther.
There we go. Yeah. Okay. So this is the main dashboard. I could follow people if I wanted advice. So I would tap follow users. I'm not following anyone. I don't know who these people are or where they came from.
But if I were using it, you could.
I could follow you. Yeah.
Okay. So can I show you something and say, does this spark joy in you? And would you like it? That would be nice.
Can I
dump this on you?
You could do that. In an app, that might be easier. So here are all your tasks. She says to start with your clothing.
Oh, this is good. Yeah.
I never got further than clothing.
That's the easiest one to start with.
Right. So start here. Put your clothing in one spot. Take a before photo. That feels good. And then use the list below to go through your pile.
Nice.
And then you can take the before photos and then take the after. Because she also gives you specific folding techniques, which are amazing. And those have stuck. It's amazing. Once you're folding your underwear in the KonMari way, life just becomes wonderful.
You can't fold your underwear?
Yes, you can.
Really?
I think there should be videos on folding, but this is the community. I don't know if there are.
Well, I guess if you had big granny pants, you could fold them.
you can fold your underwear.
Okay.
I wish there were
You know what? I wear a thong, and it's just hard to fold.
Okay. If you are interested out there, you Google fold your underwear KonMari method, and it will show you how to fold any underwear, no matter
how
big or
small. You
know
what I do with my t-shirts? I roll them up.
Yes. You roll.
Does she suggest that?
Yeah. Everything gets rolled into, you know, just like the packing, and then you stick it in.
Yeah. And you get more in that way.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Why is that? I've never understood that. Like, if you pack a bag and throw everything in there, aren't you pushing all the air out and closing it? But it never takes as little space as if you carefully fold every item.
It's physics.
Physics.
Right? But the reason why you fold and put things like, especially your underwear, I'm going to stop talking about underwear after. Thank you, Brian.
I am not doing that. Look.
It will change your life. It literally will change your life because you can see everything.
Yeah, because you'll no longer have time to watch TV because you'll be so busy folding underwear.
No, you can see everything. Everything doesn't hide back there. And you're like, I didn't know I had that. It's all, and it feels good every time you open the drawer.
She, of course, Marie Kondo comes from Japan where space is at a premium.
Mm-hmm.
And it makes sense that, you know, she talks about this in the book. I mean, when you have a very small space, but you can get in a very small space, everything you need to live, not more, but everything you need to live in a very small space if you follow these rules. Mm-hmm. I think that makes a lot of sense.
Yeah. So start with clothes and then you move on to everything else. So do this before you move because you don't want to bring all that stuff. Because, I mean, you know, have you ever gotten to the point where your house is so messy that you just want to move?
Like right now. In fact, that's why we're leaving the brick house.
Because it's so messy.
Yeah, there's where we're going.
I want to KonMari everything in the brick house.
Yeah. Oh, look, they got the walls up. That's good. That's a start.
You should KonMari all of us into little, roll us all up so we fit inside there. Otherwise, I'm worried that we're not going to.
Yeah. You can't roll up a bra, though, right?
No, you saw how she has them set out.
Yeah, I thought that was interesting the way she did
that. So you can see them.
Okay. So some things you can't do.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Roll the things you can.
Mm-hmm. So do you have any more moving
Don't forget to take the rolled up socks out of your bra before you put it on.
You don't put socks and bras in the same drawer. Didn't you see that?
No, I'm
separate
sorry.
Drawer.
I thought everything was in one drawer.
No. I don't think so. That's not why. I have two drawers. Socks, you lay them one on top of each other, and then you roll those together.
Yes,
no,
I do that.
Sock balls.
That's
not
a terrible
that.
Idea because it stretches the rim of the sock.
Mm-hmm.
I was, for years, I couldn't understand why my socks always fell down. And I realized I'm stretching them out by making a sock ball.
Yep, nope.
It's satisfying lay them together, to make a sock
ball. Fold them up.
But don't, yeah, that's what I do now.
We've gotten really far from iPad and iOS. But everybody has socks and underwear, I hope.
This is a universal problem.
Yes. I was doing some research. I found some other stuff. There's a site called Move Buddha. You might want to check that out. It's
is
not
it also
app.
Like a, you know, like a Zen kind of?
No, no? It's just like getting quotes on your move.
Another yeah, that's a good thing.
Zillow. Yeah. You might want to use
Love Zillow.
And of course, this is a sponsor, but Rocket Mortgage, if you are going to, if
Let's
you know,
give
you
them
wanna,
a plug.
Yeah, if you're gonna.
Here's
buy
my
a new
favorite
house.
Moving app. I'm very excited about this one. This taught me everything I need to know about moving. I learned in kindergarten. Actually, you know what this is for? Is parents who have kids and they're moving, and it's kind of helpful to. Prepare the kids for what could be very kind of a traumatic event. This is from Sesame Street.
My mommy said she had some big news.
Uh-oh.
Our family would be leaving the military base where we live.
No!
This
brings back childhood
I have
trauma,
a lot
anyway.
To do to get ready.
Yeah.
And I'm going to need your help.
This is, you know, the iPad is great for younger kids because in a way that isn't kind of parental, they can have this and they can kind of learn this. And it's a way to diffuse a situation that is difficult.
I think you should show this at the production meeting tomorrow so that we're all feel more comfortable with this move.
This is required watching for our entire staff.
Because I'm feeling traumatized by having
too.
To move. I don't want to go.
Yeah.
So do you think you're the little green guy or...
To my box.
No, I'm the mommy.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it's okay. We're okay. I don't know if you've seen my boxes are in there and I can't put any things in them. So
drag to lower left to unlock. It has a lock mode, of course. And so this is actually a really great thing. How to break the news, how to prepare for the move, settling in, managing emotions. So there's a whole parental resources section, starting a new school, all the things you
there's
deal
a lot
of.
To do for
and then
our
there
move.
There's a great
choose what
kid
you wanna do
friendly
next.
Introduction.
You were joking, but this is true. And Creamy Corncob also is right. He says this is unrealistic. The mom isn't screaming and cursing.
That's the point. Is you if you have the urge to scream and curse, you give them the iPad and say, play this game, and you go in the other room. Play it now.
So you have your new place, apartment, house, yurt, whatever it is. You're moving in. What's the first thing you want to do? What's the first thing you want to put up on your wall?
I'm guessing I have it on a blue clipboard here somewhere.
Yes.
Oh, right. You want to put pictures up. Actually, you know, this is very timely.
Mm-hmm.
So one of the things we did to make our house a home when we moved 3 years ago, Lisa said, you know, I really want to, we take a lot of pictures. And normally they're just on the computer. We really want to get those pictures up on the wall. So what she did, which I love this, she put shelves in along the wall. And now we put pictures up there. And it's so great. But you can't just put like a picture up there because it's floppy and it falls over. So we frame the pictures. And by the way, if you've not been to the frame store recently, you could spend a lot of money on framing. So we're really glad we found FrameBridge. FrameBridge is an online store to get your framing done. They've got the experts there. You're not on your own. You can use the FrameBridge site or the FrameBridge app. You can even take pictures, upload for directly from your Instagram, which is where a lot of people these days are putting their favorite pictures. Select a frame from their extensive collection or let FrameBridge designers work with you. You could preview your art in any frame style. They've got them all, a classic or kind of eclectic or I like the canvas style. I think that's kind of nice. It's kind of relaxed. Once they get your art, they'll measure it, they'll cut it, they'll build your custom frame, just as the frame shop would, with the highest quality materials, real wood moldings, acid-free matte. That's really important because you don't want that picture, especially if it's like, by the way, it doesn't just have to be photos. It could be your child's drawing. By the way, kids, if you frame that and put that on the wall, they feel so validated and loved. We've framed things like motherboards, circuitry. There's all sorts of stuff you can frame. But they're going to make sure it's mounted perfectly with acid-free mat and foam board and shatterproof acrylic glazing that will not only protect your art from UV rays, but it's not going to break and put glass on the floor. It also is lower glare than glass. It's really nice. Your carefully packaged piece, and I opened my FrameBridge piece on the air a couple of weeks ago on Twit. It's packaged so beautifully that it's just right. And when you check out, they will give you a delivery timeline so you know exactly when your art will arrive. Now, if you've gone to the frame store, often framing a print, a $30 print you bought will cost hundreds and hundreds of dollars. That's very discouraging. FrameBridge prices start at $39 for an Instagram. For a big movie poster, big size movie poster, only $139. And shipping is always free in the contiguous United States. Plus, they have a happiness guarantee. If you're not happy with your finished piece, they will give you a full refund. No one will do that, no art store. So diplomas, maps, family photos. I'll show you, here's an example. We did this, Lisa took this most beautiful picture. The sun was setting, it was just gorgeous, of her son Michael and his best friend Tanner. And here's the frame. We sent it to FrameBridge, and it is just gorgeous. And it's done beautifully. They send you, it's ready for mounting, but they even send you the tool, you know, the stuff you need to hang it on the wall. I really love the work. I get the full shot here because I think you want to see the whole thing. Isn't that beautiful? That's FrameBridge. Whether you're looking for eclectic frames for the photos in your phone or you need help planning a gallery wall, FrameBridge has you covered. Start framing the things you love today. FrameBridge.com. Oh, and we're going to give you an even better deal if you use our promo code iOS, 15% off your first order. So get several things. FrameBridge.com. iOS is the offer code. I couldn't be happier. We're doing all our framing with them.
I love it. Yeah. I've been looking for service for so long. I did a large print. It's like huge, a picture that I took in Cancun. It was only $140.
That's amazing.
And they did designer's choice. They matted it for me. I'll take a picture and show it to you.
They do a nice job, don't they?
Yeah, it is.
I'm thrilled with it.
Yeah, great job. I could not have. People are really surprised that I took the picture. I'm like, what? You took that? But it's the mat and the frame.
You know, we all have pictures we want to save. And there's always, no matter who, there's a great picture that you would love to preserve. Don't bury it on your hard drive. Get it printed.
Even the cheap places are expensive now.
Oh, so there's
this
nowhere.
Is great. I love it. And you don't have to leave your house.
There's nowhere you can go anymore except FrameBridge, FrameBridge.com.
Mm-hmm. All right. So we got some news. You ready for some Apple news?
Seems like we are kind of converging on the big day.
Yes.
It's going to be in the next few weeks. And I'm not talking about our move. I'm talking about an Apple announcement.
Yes, September 7th, we think.
No one knows.
Not for the iPhone.
In the past, it's always been the first Wednesday after Wednesday, right? First Wednesday after Labor Day, which would be the 7th,
mm-hmm.
I think. Yeah.
But I'm not, the news
today. We don't
today,
know. Apple
don't
doesn't
know.
Say. Apple doesn't
know.
Say. Nobody, we're just guessing.
We're guessing.
Yeah.
But Apple also hasn't said this, but Apple analyst Ming-Chi Kuo says there's going to be 3 new iPads next year.
Oh.
So, and
he's
then the year after
though.
That, there's going to be a crazy, yeah. maybe a flexible iPad with an AMOLED screen. So
right.
the 3 new iPads he is anticipating for next year is a 12.5-inch iPad
Pro 2. So we're already
Pro 2.
Talking about the rumors for next year.
For iPads. mm-hmm. We are.
But that means no new iPads this year. That's actually the main point, in my opinion, of that story is, if you were waiting till later this year, because Apple sometimes announces new iPads in October, I wouldn't expect maybe an updated mini, maybe. That's one they're due for.
Maybe. He said nothing about minis. He said that there's going to be an iPad Pro 2, 12.5-inch iPad Pro. So the same as those first one we got, but probably
12.7.
Better.
Yeah.
12.7. And then a new size, 10.5-inch iPad Pro.
Oh,
so not another one of this size. Yeah, in between this one and the bigger one.
I love, this is the 9.7. Right. I really, this to me was a sweet spot for the iPad Pro. You
really
and I
like
both had
too.
The big one, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I like the littler one better, frankly.
I do too. And if you like this size, but you don't want to shell out the cash for the Pro, he says a cheaper 9.7-inch is also going to come.
Oh, interesting. Kind of the replacement for the Air?
I guess so, yeah.
Maybe, yeah.
So, but he didn't make any mention of a mini, but then there was that 2018.
I hope they're not going to kill the mini. I think this would be the year to do it. I got the mini, was it this year, the new mini? It was January, wasn't it? And I really like that for travel.
Mm-hmm.
Although I did take the Pro with me.
I think I don't need a size between this and this. I think
I guess you're right. Maybe there doesn't. Because they have a big phone now.
Yeah. Like I don't anything yeah. between that. That's just no.
Okay.
Just no.
Right.
So that's what we're thinking.
Is he okay? So now the chairman's asking an interesting question. Apple has a different fiscal year than in the calendar year. If he's talking about fiscal 2017, that actually their first quarter begins in October. So that could be, if it's fiscal 2017, that could be October. If it's calendar 2017, obviously it's next year. So does he make that clear?
No.
He's a financial analyst. He might be talking about fiscal year.
Yeah. I
didn't actually think about that.
That's a
Thank
good
you, chat
question.
Room, for pointing
Let's
that out.
See.
Yeah.
Yeah. 20,
So it could be October.
Maybe. Yeah.
You know, it's funny because as much as we talk about the iPad, and this used to be iPad today, it's now iOS today, the iPad isn't the hot product it used to be. I think partly because everybody's got one. Everybody who wanted one anyway has got one. And there's not really a lot of urgency to upgrade. That's why what Ming-Chi Kuo says might be important, because what are they going to do to get people back in the store? There you go. There's the current line. You've got all the way up to 12.9 inches for the iPad Pro, 9.7 for the iPad Pro smaller one, the iPad Air 2, which is the same size. The Mini 4, that's the one that came out earlier this year, I think. And then there's an old one, the Mini 2, which is their low-cost version of the iPad.
He does say that 10-inch one, that is designed for the enterprise, for education and governments.
The mid-size.
Yes.
Yeah.
He said, so the overall demand for iPads is decreasing, but the demand among enterprise, government, schools is increasing.
Interesting.
So,
well, if he's talking about fiscal year 2017, that could be October. That'd be interesting to see.
Yeah. And then that means next year we'll get the flexible ones that we could throw like Frisbees if we felt like it.
Right.
That's exciting.
Yeah.
So in the USENIX security conference last week.
Love that. I go every year.
You do not go. You go virtually by reading about
it. I think about it.
You think about it.
I love security conferences. USENIX is as old as they get. That's been around for a long time.
So what did you think about Matthew Green from Johns Hopkins saying iMessage is garbage?
So Matthew Green, we really love. A very highly respected cryptographer, teaches at Johns Hopkins, also runs a team there. And you see the names of all the members of the team at Johns Hopkins who do things like analyze the security of devices of software. He said, in a nutshell, what Apple calls end-to-end iMessage encryption really is no better than SSL, surfing securely, and has some particular flaws. He's not implying that it's crackable. That's not what they've discovered. But what they are saying is there are a couple of potential flaws. One, and this is a weird one, if I send you an iMessage and it's not delivered, Apple stores that iMessage for a period of time, hoping to get it to you. So if I send it to you and it's delivered, it's encrypted from my point to your point. That's true end-to-end encryption, and nobody can read it along the way. Only you can read it, and only I can read it. But if it doesn't get to you, Apple stores it on their servers where, in fact, it can be read. It can be read with anybody who has your iCloud key. And this is the kind of the point I've made several times, which is Apple's iCloud is not trust no one encryption. They have the key to your iCloud backup. So when that iMessage is stored in iCloud, law enforcement could go to Apple and say, we want it, and they could give it to them, just as they could your iCloud backup. In fact, if you back up your iMessages on iCloud, same problem. Now you may say, well, if it's law enforcement, okay. But that also means a rogue employee at Apple could look at it, and maybe more to the point, if a bad guy were able to break into iCloud, and this has happened in the past, they would also be able to get it. So Matthew's suggestion, I think it's a good suggestion, is Apple should adopt the signal encryption technology that WhatsApp's using, that Facebook is going to use, that Google is going to use. That is true end-to-end encryption, and would give us a little bit more sense of security. If it matters to you, it's something that's good to know. I don't think it makes a big difference. In fact, I don't know what traffic you send on your iMessages. But when I ask Lisa, should I get bread at the store, I don't think it's that important that it be totally secure. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
The fact that iMessages is kind of mostly secure is is good enough for me.
But what if you suddenly got some sort of information and you became a whistleblower?
If I were, let's put it in a real concrete situation. If I were in a country where the government doesn't like dissidents, and I was a dissident and I was sharing information, organizing information for protest or giving information to another government, and I wanted to protect myself against that government, I would not use iMessages. Mm-hmm. Absolutely not.
So is Apple making continuous updates based on this information from this team?
Yes. In fact, Matthew Green pointed out that at least one of the things they talked about was fixed right away by Apple. So Apple is listening and paying attention. I think the two things I mentioned, it's not likely they'll get fixed because that's kind of structurally how iMessages works. It's possible, though, that Apple could adopt a protocol that would keep those undelivered messages encrypted in a way that no one could read, including Apple. Apple doesn't want to be able to read it. You understand? They don't want to have to give this information to governments, not just the U.S. government, but to other, you know, if China comes a calling and says, hey, we want this information, the last thing Apple wants to do is have to turn it over. And they would if they operate in China.
So an update on those new iPads. It says 2017 F and 2018 F,
well,
which
F means fiscal.
So yeah. Fiscal year 2016 runs September to September. So anything after September 24th.
Thank you, Gardner, for the clarification.
Yes, thank you.
It is fiscal year. So good. This means there may be, and Ming-Chi Kuo's reliability is pretty good.
Yeah. He
Not
said
perfect,
last
but pretty
year,
good.
He said that by 2017 we'd all be charging our iPhones over the air. And we discussed that, and you said, no, that's not going to happen.
It's a good, interesting idea. Remember, that one of the things that he uses for his sources is not Apple Cupertino, Apple in California, but the Chinese suppliers who make these things. So a lot of times, he'll have information about something Apple's making prototypes of, or maybe even manufacturing in small numbers, but doesn't necessarily intend to sell. Mm-hmm. They wouldn't be making these new iPads. Well, maybe they would be, actually. They could already be making them. If they're going to announce them in next month or 2 months, they could already be making them.
Yeah, so I guess we could hear about them on September 7th and then be able to buy
them. That's good. All right.
Okay. All right. Well, rumors, also patents, are things we don't know, but we like to talk about anyway. Patently, Apple reported on a patent application for a wearable that measures electrocardiographic signals, ECGs. Its sole function is going to be to monitor the heart. This is only a patent application, but if it comes to fruition, it is separate from the Apple Watch. It can be worn in different locations on the body, like a ring or a brooch or a pendant.
Oh, doesn't have to be on your wrist?
No. On your wrist, you might be able to touch your finger on it and then get your ECG way.
I see.
It might touch another part of your body and be able to know.
It'd be kind of cool. Your doctor could say, hey, you better give me an ECG. Or you could say, I'm not feeling well. And the doctor could say, hey, send me that data. That would be kind of cool. I should point out, though, that Apple patents everything that it thinks it could possibly patent. That's the process in all of these big companies that have lawyers working there. They often have several lawyers who are responsible for making patents. And I've been told the way it works at Apple is these lawyers are present at many meetings. And when anybody says anything that potentially could be a product, they go, let's patent that to prevent other people from making it first. Doesn't mean Apple plans to make it. Just it doesn't even mean Apple knows how to make it. It just means they have a patent for it.
Right. It means we can't now make a brooch.
I can't do that.
ECG brooch.
Right.
We should have a lawyer because we come up with some great ideas.
We should have a lawyer sitting at the table every time. Right,
exactly. Yeah, we should. I've been asking for that for a while, actually.
You know, I have zero patents to my name.
You have zero patents.
Yesterday we did the Game of Geeks.
Mm-hmm, I saw that.
There's only one president of the United States, only one who has a patent in his name, and you'll never guess who it is.
Obama.
Nope. I was going to say Jimmy Carter because he was a nuclear engineer, right?
Mm-hmm.
Nope. Abraham Lincoln.
Oh.
He invented a device for getting boats over land.
Huh.
Like lifting them up and transporting them.
You don't have any patents?
I have zero patents.
Okay.
And I don't think I ever will.
So go back, listen to everything he's ever recorded, all of his ideas.
Actually, Dvorak once told me that the smartest thing I could do when I was just starting Twit 11 years ago, patent all the work processes. He says that's where you make the money. When you're going to sell, your company. He said, the patents, they're the where the money is. That's what he said. Just like that. He said, that's where the money is. He said that just like that.
And you didn't do it.
No. I do have patent leather shoes. Does that count?
Nope. That is very different. Okay. Yesterday, Mike Isaac, writing in the New York Times, had a piece about NFL's deal with Twitter to live stream NFL games on Thursday.
And you may wonder, well, the first thing I think when I hear that is, I'm going to watch the NFL on my Twitter stream on my phone, but no.
No. Their sources say there's going to be an app on your Apple TV.
Apple TV.
And you'll be able to watch. So you think that's without a subscription? You'll be able to watch?
Yeah, I think it is. They'll have ads in there, of course. You don't have to subscribe to CBS to watch Thursday Night Football. It'll be sort of like that. Twitter paid a lot of money. What was it? It was $1 million a game for rights to broadcast one game a week from the NFL. It might even have been Thursday night. I can't remember. So that's not a lot. That's not as much as broadcast rights cost by any means. But I think the NFL thought, well, who's going to watch on Twitter?
Mm-hmm.
Maybe it could make a big difference.
So this is just rumors, too. Sources. Yeah. So far, we've talked about rumors, patents, and sources.
I'd have to think that if the NFL made a deal with Twitter for $1 million a game, which is not much when it comes to broadcast rights, but probably is a lot for a social network, and then Twitter says, oh, and by the way, we'll be doing it on the Apple TV, the NFL might come back to them and say, yeah, it might cost you a little more.
Right, because I don't have cable, so there's no way to watch football, any football.
Right.
I don't care. Actually, that's part of why I got rid of cable.
Because you didn't want to watch football?
I don't enjoy watching the football.
What's wrong with you? You're not American.
I'm from Texas. I was. My dad was a big Cowboy fan.
I was
forced to watch the Dallas Cowboys.
Well, that's crime. Nobody should be forced to watch the Dallas
I'm sorry.
Cowboys.
I should have given a trigger warning to anyone else who experienced the childhood I did.
Wait, you got rid of your TV just so that wouldn't happen?
The cable.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
And now my husband goes and watches it at my dad's house.
Right, at your dad's house, of course.
Right, he enjoys it.
Yeah.
So, hopefully we'll maybe get that if you like football.
Somebody was visiting our house, and maybe it was during the party on Thursday night, and said, you have so many TVs. They're pretty much, I guess that's true that we have a lot of TVs.
You have a lot of electronics in your house. I mean, anyone would expect that, but it was still more than, it always surprises me.
Steve Martin told me, we went down there last week, he said, I imagine your house just full of computers and TVs and lots of wires everywhere.
The wires aren't everywhere. I'm impressed that,
you weren't looking in the right places. Okay. There's wires everywhere.
And your toilet seats are all warm. I checked every one.
You want to explain that?
You have warm toilet seats.
We have...
you have a toilet seat warmer. I don't know what it is. All I know is it was warm.
They're all warm. They are. Did you press any of the buttons?
No,
on the side
I was scared of what would happen. I just sat down, I did what I needed to do, and then I was out of there.
Oh, you should have tried it.
No.
Because the water's warm, too.
Well, I've seen a video of it at work.
Yeah.
And I've seen it working on Facebook.
I'm kind of embarrassed about that whole thing.
You are? Oh, was I not supposed to say anything? Just forget that. Cut that out.
I go to each toilet and warm the seat before our guests arrive.
All right.
We have Toto washlets, okay? They're Japanese. Marie Kondo would approve.
She would, I'm sure. Gosh, we've talked about undergarments, toilets. Where else could we go?
the remote control actually has a temperature scale. You can have them medium, warm, super hot.
And I imagine they're cleaner as well.
They have pre-mist.
Pre-mist.
Yeah.
Yeah, I noticed that. I didn't want to mention that.
I actually had to ask at the toilet store. What the hell's pre-mist? All right.
Okay. The Apple Watch strap. There's a new Apple Watch strap that I think you might be interested in if you want a regular mechanical watch and your Apple Watch. Have you seen this? It's the Syn Apple Watch strap. It's a whole strap set. It's two little straps that strap together so that you can have an Apple Watch on one side and a mechanical watch on the other. And I can't really...
Such a really ridiculous look.
Is it?
Isn't it? That is just, I'm sorry. I might have gadgets everywhere, but this I will not do.
That's ridiculous. Brian Clark from The Next Web, I think he calls it the mullet of Apple Watch straps.
Yes.
Because it's business in the front, party in the back.
That's very clever.
So, yeah, it's it only costs $120 unless you're not buying the watch also. Then it will cost you $210.
Oh, it includes the watch?
For $120, yes.
Wait a minute, it costs more without the watch?
If you don't watch, buy the watch. It does. It costs more. They want you to buy that watch, I guess.
Wait a minute, I'm confused. You're saying it's cheaper if you get the watch.
Right. Mm-hmm. I mean, you have to also pay for the watch.
So it's $110 for the
minus
strap.
Minus the watch.
The watch.
The strap itself is $210. If you buy a watch also for whatever $1 million you're going to spend, then it's only $120.
And is it an Apple Watch or is it some other watch?
No, it's the mechanical watch.
Oh, and what kind of watch is the mechanical watch? I don't know why I'm asking questions.
S-I-N-N. They're a watch company.
They make watches? Okay.
But we talked about this on Friday. Because it's news, you know, this watch. And it's so tiny. Like, you could just get the straps and then put it on your dog, too. That was another, if you wanted to get...
Does the dog need to know what time it is?
You might want to monitor the... An Apple Watch is so much more than just the time. You might want to monitor your dog's health. You might want... Your dog might want to check Twitter. You never know.
You never know.
You don't know.
Your dog might want to know when to get out of the house before the NFL starts. All of that.
All those things.
Preseason started this weekend. Yep. Excited? Cowboys going all the way.
I believe you.
That is so crazy. That is crazy, the dual watch system. That's crazy.
It is crazy.
Wow.
But, I mean, if you can't decide, you could also wear two watches. You have two wrists.
What does the mechanical watch do that the Apple Watch doesn't do?
It's a mechanical watch. Well, here, I know it doesn't have a battery, so if your battery runs out, know what time it is.
One wrist.
That's
as bad as wearing two watches.
It's worse, I think.
Maybe it's even worse.
Yeah.
Wow. All right. Hey, there's something for everyone in this world, and that's why I like it.
Mm-hmm. Something for everything and your
something
dog.
Something for everything.
So looking at that watch
makes me hungry.
makes me hungry too? Yes.
Jinx, you owe me a Coke. Or you could just have me over for a Blue Apron meal. I love Blue Apron. Blue Apron delivers exactly the right ingredients plus the recipe card to make amazing meals to your door every week. You specify the meals, you specify the delivery day, and you save money. This is the thing I really didn't get at first. I thought, oh, this is great, but it's probably costing me more than if I did my own shopping. No, the grocery store is 60% more expensive than Blue Apron. Why? They don't have a brick and mortar store. They don't have to stock it. They just go to the best farms, 150 local farms and fisheries and ranchers across the United States. The seafood is sourced sustainably. The beef is raised humanely. The chickens are free range. The pork is ranged naturally. They use regenerative farming practices for the produce. And by the way, I mentioned all the meats, but you can also get vegetarian meals from them. It's your choice. You're going to learn how to make new dishes you've never made before. Serve them for your family. They have family plans. Or your loved one. It's a great couples thing. In fact, for date night, there's nothing better than Blue Apron. Every meal comes with a step-by-step, easy-to-follow recipe card and just the right ingredients. If you need four asparagus spears, you get four, not five. There's no waste that way. And you'll save time and you'll save, as I said, you'll save money. And by the way, you know, how often do we, you know, we have good intentions. I'm going to shop. I'm doing this tonight, by the way. I'm going to shop. I'm going to make dinner because I want to have a nice, healthy meal. And we end up eating out. We end up stopping at the fast food because, you know, bring home a bucket of chicken because it's easier. Let's not do that. Let's make a wonderful meal for our family that's good for them. And you know, it fills the house with beautiful smells. The kids come home and go, oh, what's for dinner? Oh, man. Blue Apron's mission, I'm totally behind this, is to make incredible home cooking accessible to everyone while supporting a more sustainable food system and setting the highest standards for ingredients and building a community of home chefs. That's you. Look what's on the menu. What was that? Go back there. I want that. Pesto meatball and mozzarella paninis with zucchini strips. Oh, man. And the thing is, you're going to get sometimes things that you are complicated that you would never dream of making with ingredients perhaps you've never heard of. And it gives you the confidence to know, I can do this, and next time I'm going to do it again. I love this. Whether it's Japanese ramen noodles, wild-caught Alaska salmon, heirloom tomatoes, you're getting the best ingredients. Research shows Blue Apron families cook together three times more often. It is have a family cooking night. Spiced pork burgers with goat cheese and cucumber corn salad. Summer vegetable and quinoa bowl with fairy tale eggplants, shishito peppers, and corn. Chicken tinga tacos. I hate doing these ads. They make me so hungry. With summer squash and tomato salad, I'm going to cry. Look, right now, you get your first three meals free when you go to blueapron.com/twit. So there's no reason not to try this. And I'm telling you, it will completely change your relationship with cooking, with your family. Cooking a meal from Blue Apron is making something with love. It's sharing the love with your family or your friends or your... I'm telling you, for date night, you want somebody to fall in love with you? blueapron.com/twit. You don't have to tell them. You got it from Blue Apron. Just say, did you like that? Put a couple of candles, bottle of wine. blueapron.com/twit for the first three meals free.
All right, have a correction from last week.
Oh.
Kelly wrote in to correct us, me, really. She writes, on the Olympics on iOS episode on August 8th, you were talking about working with the geniuses at the Apple store. Yeah. Megan mentioned that a genius will not try to sell you anything, but a specialist will. It is true that a genius is there to diagnose and fix issues with your Apple products, and a specialist is there to help you select the appropriate Apple product for your needs. But no one in the Apple store works on commission. I worked in my local Apple store for a year and a half, first as a specialist and then as an expert. In my experience, Apple products sell themselves. The specialists and experts are there to help users and owners determine which product and specifications will meet their needs.
Thank you.
Yeah, so I told you commission. You said, are you sure? And then the article that I read said that their sales and add-ons are monitored. I went back and read the article.
I'm sure there's some, you know, the manager will say, you know, we gotta move these microwave ovens.
Mm-hmm.
And there's some incentive. But I'm glad to hear that. Because when you sell on commission, there really is incentive to push something that maybe the customer doesn't want. They will often, I mean, even the geniuses will often recommend something, mm-hmm. you know.
But
and
their
I think
sales
that's appropriate.
Monitored.
Yeah, I think
but
that's
the specialists, their
specialists,
sales,
their
that,
sales
so that's
are
the point, though. So okay. Their sales are monitored.
That means there's a little incentive to do it. Mm-hmm. You weren't completely wrong.
No, but they don't work on commission, so.
Okay.
Leanne Matsumoto writes, she has a pick for us. She said, I found this really awesome battery pack by Skosh. It's called the Magic Mount Power Bank. What's great about this is you attach a magnet to the back of your phone, and the charger has another magnet that will attach to that when you want to charge your phone. Plug in the lightning cable, attach the battery to the back of your phone, and voila, no battery dangling from a cable in your phone. It comes in black, space gray, and gold, too. So that's nice because I do, when I have lots of battery packs and they just come, you know, they're just sort of hanging there.
Yeah.
So it's nice that they stick together like that.
Well, you know who that's for.
For
the Pokemon Go player. Let's face it.
Well, all battery, yeah. The increase
yeah,
in
but
battery packs.
That form factor definitely says Pokemon Go to me.
It does.
Yeah, doesn't it?
Do you want to say Pokemon Go or do you not want to say Pokemon Go? Are you hiding your obsession at this point or or sharing it with the
you
world?
You know, I see people all the time now walking down the street with their smartphone in their hand. That in and itself is not, you know, probative that you're playing Pokemon Go. But when there's a wire coming out of it attached to a battery, that's pretty much an indicator. You're playing Pokemon Go, right?
Yeah, I think battery packs, they said they've doubled.
Doubled
since Pokemon
in when Pokemon Go came out in mm-hmm. two weeks. Doubled.
Yeah. But it could just be also that people are on vacation. We don't know. It might be just a correlation, not a causation.
Yeah, you're right. Could just be that.
But
yeah.
Probably.
Same time, they doubled over the same time the year before.
Yeah.
So probably. That means it's probably.
Probably. Pokemon. Unless batteries have just gotten worse.
You know what? That actually is true. You could probably say that some of that is due to the fact that battery life is, for almost everything. I mean, if you're talking iPhones, no. But in general, for everything else, it's going down a lot.
Mm-hmm.
6S Plus still is a really, one of the longest lasting batteries I've ever used on a phone, unless you play Pokemon Go. And
yeah.
Then 2 hours and you're out.
Exactly. Yeah, this battery, yeah, I've never had a phone
that's consistently easily, right?
Easily.
It's so great. I love the 6S Plus for that reason.
Mm-hmm. Here's a question. It's sort of a tech support question. Are
okay.
You ready for this?
Hey, that's my specialité.
Corey Pike asks, when the 9.7 iPad Pro was released, I picked one up. The issue that I'm having is that I will be working and the screen will jump to the soft load page, the black screen with the white Apple logo. I have taken it to the Apple store twice. They run a diagnostic and they tell me there is nothing wrong, but the problem persists. Has there been any word of this happening to others?
Happens all the time. It's called a respring. The computer, the pad isn't crashing. Springboard is. So Springboard is the program that's always running on the iPad that's showing you all this stuff. That's, you could say it's the launcher, the Finder if you're a Macintosh user, Explorer if you're a Windows user. It's the user interface before you run an app. And it is not at all unusual, I'm sorry to say, for an iPad or an iPhone to respring. That means Springboard is crashed. And the way you know is the difference between the computer crashing and the Springboard crashing is you'll see the Apple, the white Apple in the black background, and then within a few seconds, you'll be back. If it is a complete reset of the iPad, it's going to take longer, as you know, to restart an iPad, to reload the operating system. So I think, just judging from what he described, it's a respring. We talk about this on Mac Break Weekly. The reason I know the name respring is, Renee Ritchie has mentioned this. I found it to be less common in the newer versions. I'm now running iOS 10, and I haven't had any resprings. When iOS 9 first came out, it was really common. So the only advice is to make sure you update and keep updating. And when you get to iOS 10, you should be better off. It doesn't usually have anything to do with a hardware flaw, a physical flaw. It could be that there is a program you use that I don't use that's causing it to happen more. That very easily could be. But it's hard to track down who caused the respring. I think it's just pretty common. iOS 10 has been rock solid. It's the most solid. Oh, there's a new public beta.
Yes,
just came
there
out,
is.
Number 5. I think we're getting really close to release because this 4 came out just a few days ago. So mm-hmm. I think we're getting real close to release. That's when you start to see do the public beta and see if that fixes the resprings. Mm. I think at this point, by the time you're watching this show, it's very close to finished. It certainly is almost bug-free as far as I can tell. Should I update now?
Sure, why not? Well,
I got a show to do.
Okay.
It's so tempting, though. I want to do it. It's right. Big. It's 1.78 gigs, which is going to take a while to download.
Yeah. You did that one so well. How about another?
Sure.
Another tech support-ish question by Terry Orr. He wrote, downloaded 9.3.4 on my 6S Plus. Now my phone won't download any apps. It just says waiting. Same for Apple Music.
I hate that. So have you had that happen?
I haven't.
What? Really?
Yeah.
So you get stuck. An app install or update gets stuck. And then it's grayed out, right? And you tap it, and it says waiting, pausing. You could tap it again, and it'll say down installing. And you tap it, and nothing happens, and it says waiting, and then pausing. It's stuck. So you have to figure out, if there's only one icon doing that, my suggestion would be press, hold it, and delete it. Restart. You really do want to restart your iPad after that. Press and hold the on-off switch until you get slide to turn off. Turn it off and do it again. And then go to the store and try again. If a download gets stuck in an update, when you've got a list of updates or you're downloading a list of applications and one gets stuck, the rest of them can't proceed. So that's what's, I think, happening, is you've got a download that just won't persist. And there are lots of reasons that could happen. Could be it got corrupted during the download. It could be that, before I did iOS 10, I downloaded from Apple. There's a whole bunch of new icons for Messenger, right? I don't know if it's on here, actually. There were hearts and the old Apple Macintosh icons and stuff like that. Well, on my iOS 9 devices, they couldn't download them because it didn't make sense for iOS 9. It's only for iOS 10. But I would get the little grayed out icon. It's things like that. It just means it's trying to download, but it's failed. Delete it or restart and then delete it. Sometimes just a restart is all it takes to get it kick-started again. So maybe I should reverse the order of operations I was suggesting. First, press and hold the on-off switch till you get the slide to turn off or slide to power off thing. Power it off, turn it back on again. Sometimes that's enough to get the download completed. If it doesn't work, then you want to delete it and start over, re-download the application.
Okay, so when you have a bunch of apps and it says like 256 apps need updating, do you just update them all at once?
Yeah, don't you?
I do, but then, you know, now that I think about it, I sometimes get that.
That's
slow.
When it'll happen. You're right. Yeah, yeah, all it takes is one. You know, here's the thing. Aren't these supposed to just download automatically?
That's what I don't understand either. I want all automatic updates. I never turn them off.
They never do. Yeah. So I don't... some do, right? Like Pokemon Go updated today without me doing anything. These programs, and there's the hearts, by the way, updated yesterday without me doing anything. I don't know why these four are stuck. But I think probably the answer to your conundrum is don't wait until you get 250 apps to download. But, you know, check every once in a while. If you open the App Store, you'll see, of course, a badge on the updates button that says you have some updates. And I actually, for some reason, you do have to manually start those updates. Mine obviously are automatically updating. I didn't do these manually, but not always. And that's really puzzling me.
All right. Next question. This is an easy one. This was just in case you didn't get those right, then I was going to give you an easy one. Ben from Omaha asks,
please,
do you know if iOS 10 will be for the first generation iPad mini?
It will not. iPad mini. Oh, you threw me a curve there. Will not be for the first generation iPad. No, I don't. I think it probably won't.
Yeah,
but
that's
I'll
what
have
the,
to check.
The press release says iPad mini 2 or higher.
Yeah.
So,
because the original iPad mini is essentially is an iPad mini, I think. I mean, iPad regular. So, yeah, you know what? You might say, well, they're only a few years old. Why can't you update them? But they really did have slow processors and low memory. I think maybe one of the reasons, a lot of less RAM. But for whatever reason, they're not. And listen to them, because if you don't, we've seen this happen again and again. People install the update on iPads they shouldn't. They manage somehow to do so, and it just runs terribly. They're telling you for a reason. Don't try.
Okay, this is the last one. It's not a question, just a comment from Kenny N. from Springfield, Missouri. He writes, thank you for asking about accessibility in iOS 10. Remember, we talked a little bit about how iOS 10 was a little more accessible looking, and we also agreed that we can't really talk too much about accessibility. Because
we're not experts.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Kenny says, I use the VoiceOver screen reader for iOS, and I really enjoy Apple's accessibility. Sometimes when people contact the developer for accessibility, some actually make their app accessible later because they've learned about it from other people, but others scratch their heads and wonder, what in the world is this person talking about?
I know. We should really raise... it's our job to raise awareness of this, you know? It's really important that you make your apps work for everybody. Mm-hmm. You want to, if you're an app developer, you want the biggest audience, right? Make it work in as many ways for as many people as possible.
So thank you, Kenny, for writing. And if anybody else uses accessibility for whatever reason, email me at megan@twit.tv. We'd love to hear about certain apps or certain features in iOS that you use that help you different accessibility issues, or even maybe it's not an accessibility feature. It's some sort of something else that you figured out. We'd love to hear it. You can email me, megan@twit.tv or ios@twit.tv.
Yeah, sure, you betcha.
What do you have there?
Oh, I love this. They just sent me this from the tracker. They've sent every... Did you get one with your...
I got three with Tech News Today on it and
nice.
Three with iOS Today on
yeah.
it. And we've been using it. One of my boys put it on their drone.
Oh, that's cute. Mm-hmm. Oh, what a good idea.
Mm-hmm.
We're talking about the tracker. So this is the greatest thing ever. Put it on your drone. I never thought of that. So it's a Bluetooth tracker. It's small, it's thin, it's light because it's anodized aluminum. And the nice thing about this is it's battery powered, but the battery goes about a year, easy to replace. So this isn't going to stop working at one time. Now, it pairs to your phone, but it's a two-way tracker. See this button at the bottom? So the idea is, okay, I'm going to put this on my keys or on my drone or whatever. And that way, if I lose it, I can find it again. I have the tracker app on my phone. I pair the two. And when the keys go missing, I can look at my tracker app and see where they were seen last. But it goes the other way, too. If I walk out the door without my phone, but I've got my keys, and I go, oh, where did I leave my phone? I can press this button, and my phone will howl. You can configure it to make any sound you want. But it'll do it. Even if the phone is silenced, it'll do it. So you will find your phone. The other thing that's great about this is you probably are thinking in your head, because you're smart, well, wait a minute, Leo, if it's Bluetooth, that only goes about 30 meters, about 100 feet. what happens if I get outside that range? It's not, the software's not going to see the tracker anymore. Yes, but Tracker has created the world's largest crowd GPS system. The way this works, your keys, they're lying on the beach. You left them there last night. You went home. You're more than 100 feet away. But the next time somebody with the Tracker software on their phone walks by, the Tracker goes, hey, hey, call Leo. Tell Leo, I'm here. I'm here. And it doesn't call him. And you don't have to do anything. But it will automatically pop up a notification on my phone saying, hey, your keys have been spotted right here. So everybody's helping you. Everybody being 1.5 million trackers in the continental United States alone. 1.5 million. So this is really nice. It's like if you, it's as if you broadcast to the whole world, hey, I lost my keys. If anybody sees them, let me know. And it works. It works. You see, you love these images. Look at that. Go back up a little bit. The custom UV image right on there. That's how they did this. This is a UV LED image. And that's how they did the iOS today. They could put your face on. They put any image you want on there. That's a nice feature. Put it on your drone with a picture of your house or something. I don't know. But by the way, they're small enough and light enough. You could put it on your dog. You could put it, and they have a waterproof casing that goes in it. So you could do, just put it around your cat's neck. It's small enough even to go on a cat. There you go. On your purse, I keep it in my man bag because I don't want to lose that. That's got everything in it. Oh, a bike. I never thought of that. Put it on your bike. Look, you'll think of 1,000 ways you can use the Tracker. And I'll tell you what, we're going to get you 30% off your entire order right now if you go to thetracker.com and use our promo code iOS today. It's T-H-E-T-R-A-C-K-R. There's no E at the end there. Thetracker.com. Promo code is iOS today, 30% off your entire order. Think of some of the things you could put your tracker on. You'll never lose anything. I love that. Look at that. Again. TheTracker.com. Use the promo code iOS today, and you get 30% off. Aren't these pretty? I really like these. Wait a minute. Wait a minute. Megan, why are you looking so stylish?
Mm-hmm.
Don't I wish I had that big old leather top hat of my youth?
Yeah, and the cape.
And the cape.
We should have capes, too.
Capes would be good.
Yeah, maybe that's what we'll start.
And capes then. And swords.
Yes. Right now, we just have caps, because cap rhymes with app.
Yes.
And this is our favorite app.
App cap time.
App cap time.
Huh?
I'm going to go first.
Okay,
I
you
do.
Start.
Ladies first.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any wishes? Like just something that you wish would be
I
true?
I wish for all the wishes. That's the best wish. Everybody should wish for that.
Just something that you'd like to change
a wish
in your
of
life.
Something I'd like
just
to change
something
my life.
In your
I'd
own
I'd like to
life.
Lose weight.
Lose weight. Okay. We're going to use Whoop. Have you heard
Whoop?
Of Whoop?
No.
Whoop. There it is. Whoop.
This will help me lose weight?
It might. So here's Whoop. Let's see if you can see it because it's
get
there
your
we go.
App cap out of
Whoop.
The way.
Yeah. It's Whoop. An iPhone app, which is better,
that's
you know,
right.
But you can see it.
Yeah,
so Whoop when you feel uneasy. Whoop stands for the W means wish.
Wish.
The O means outcome.
Outcome.
So you're going to imagine the best outcome if your wish comes true. Yeah. The O means obstacle. Some obstacles.
Like a hat in the way.
Obstacles.
Okay. Yep.
Here, let me do that. There's an obstacle. And the P is for a plan. You're going to make a plan.
Okay.
All right?
Okay.
So let's Whoop. You ready
let's
to Whoop?
Whoop. I'm ready to Whoop. Okay,
relax.
First,
relax. Take a quiet moment. Make yourself comfortable. The next minute just belongs to you.
Oh, that's nice. That's a great
everybody,
way. Every app should just start that way.
Mm-hmm. Everyone, hopefully everyone at home is also Whooping. Let's get started. Choose one of the domains below. Go for professional, health, or interpersonal.
Health.
So do you still want health?
Health.
Okay.
Yeah. I have a lot of health goals.
What is the time for fulfilling your wish? 24 hours or 1 month?
1 month.
Or no time frame. One month. That's okay. Good. That's good. Okay. What is your wish? Think about your next month. What is your most important wish or concern in your health life? Pick a wish that is challenging for you, but that you can fulfill.
Right. Not easy, but not hard either.
Right.
I'd like to lose 2 pounds.
Okay. I'm going to do it with you too, because I would like to give up Diet Coke.
Oh, you should.
I should.
Yeah.
It's a bad habit.
Yeah. You know, there's a whole refrigerator full of it.
I know. That's my obstacle. Okay. So you're losing weight. I'm giving up Diet Coke.
Yeah. Okay.
Let's continue.
Should I keep breathing?
Let's do yours. We'll do yours. Yeah. Lose weight.
Lose 2 pounds.
Lose 2 pounds.
Specific, right?
Yes.
You want to be specific.
2 pounds.
Yeah. You can write LBS. That's good. Okay.
Lose 2 pounds.
Yes.
Okay.
What's the best outcome?
What's the best outcome?
I lose 20 pounds.
What would be the best thing, the best outcome about fulfilling your wish? How would fulfilling your wish make you feel? How would losing 2 pounds make you feel?
It'd make me feel great, and I wouldn't feel hungry. I just would feel lighter in my loafers.
Feel
great and
great.
And less hungry. And never hangry. Yeah, there you go. That's okay. Perfect.
Okay.
Perfect.
Never
perfect goal.
Hungry. Yeah. Continue.
Yeah.
Okay. Now take a moment and imagine the outcome. Imagine things fully.
Oh, good.
I'm imagining.
I look like George Clooney. Yeah, I get that big movie role that I was promised 28 years ago, but was too fat for.
Right.
Okay, good.
And Daniel Dye in the chat room is saying, doesn't Diet Coke make you lose weight? I'm not convinced that it is.
Does it make you do anything?
I'm giving up Diet Coke. Leo doesn't have that addiction. So
this is separate.
Okay. So you're imagining things fully. Identify your obstacle. What is it within you that holds you back from fulfilling your wish? What stands in the way of you fulfilling your wish? What is your main inner obstacle?
I love to eat.
You love to eat. Mine is the refrigerator full of Diet Coke, which my office is right next to, unfortunately.
Mm-hmm.
Well, 2 years. Okay. You love to eat.
I love to eat. And food is everywhere. You think your Diet Coke problem is hard. There's food everywhere.
But there's healthy food. I mean, you're not going to stop eating.
Okay. Add one more word.
Okay.
Pizza.
Pizza. Is everywhere.
I love to eat pizza.
Yeah.
That's an obstacle.
I love to eat, period. Pizza.
Yeah, okay. That's it right there.
Now take a moment and imagine the obstacle.
A world without pizza.
Imagine things fully. The obstacle is that there's pizza everywhere.
Yes, it's everywhere.
That is that obstacle. Imagine it's in your way.
What should I imagine about it?
Just imagine the obstacle. The obstacle is food everywhere.
Oh, I'm seeing a giant, delicious pizza pie, maybe with a little sausage, some pepperoni, right on the table in front of
me. Okay, now we're going to make an if-then plan. Okay, here's our plan. The whoop.
Whoop. Puff.
What can you do to overcome your obstacle? Name one action you can take or thought you can think to overcome your obstacle. So the obstacle for you is food is everywhere. What can you do?
You can't. That's the problem. What can you do? You can't go
anywhere. Make a plan. So you're faced with a pizza.
Okay,
the pizza is in front of you.
I will eat celery instead.
Will you?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Celery. I like celery.
You actually lost a lot of weight. So you have done a lot of this.
Yes.
So it is possible.
I will eat celery.
You only said 2 more pounds.
I will eat so much celery that I cannot bite another piece of that delicious pizza with the sausage and the pepperoni. Oh, God, I'm fat. Oh, there's pizza everywhere. Pizza man. Pizza the hut.
Okay, read it once more and imagine it. I love to eat pizza. Then I will eat celery. Lots of celery.
It's so pathetic. That's what's wrong with diets in a nutshell.
Whoop.
Ah.
You whooped.
Now, is it going to remind me? Is it going to...
No.
Or is, that's it. It's done.
That's it.
It's not going to do anything.
No.
Because it's in my
head. You can go
head.
Back.
Oh, you can go back and look.
Mm-hmm. Here was my goal. Give
Wait
up
minute,
Diet
What
Coke.
Is the percentage there? How do I...
I've done none of those things.
Yeah. So how do you get more?
How do you
add to the percentage? Look.
I don't know.
You can just do the little slider.
Yeah.
Slide it there.
This was my other goal, to make a smarter home. Don't you have that goal, too?
Smarter home?
So...
No, I want my home to be dumber. Look, you're done.
I'm done.
Nice job.
Done.
Ah, whoop.
There, smarter home.
Nice.
All right.
No, you know what? What is, of course, the journey is the reward. The process is the key in that. And by going through the process, I will eat celery next time I have a piece of pizza.
Next time you see pizza.
I like celery.
Say, whoop.
It ain't pizza, but it's, you know, if I ate that. Instead, you want to see my app?
Yes, I do.
So this came to me from Steve Gibson. Steve is the king. You know, we get a lot of app caps. I get a lot of app caps from Steve. He likes casual games, games he can play just quickly, whether, you know, he's getting a cup of coffee or he wants to take a break or whatever. And he recommended this game some time ago. And I'll tell you a couple of things that Steve's looking for in a game. He looks for an intellectual challenge, and he's looking for something that doesn't make him tense. And time limits make him tense, right? There are a lot of games. I like games where there's some time limit. You know, I don't mind being a little tense, but he doesn't like. So he recommended Clocky. Now, this is hard to find because it's a traditional game of sliding bricks. You can actually get a physical Clocky, but this is hundreds of Clockies. So you're going to look for, quote, Clocky, end quote. Oh, well, let's not start here because this is where I am, and this is a very advanced Clocky. So I'm not going to make you do that. Let's go back. These are all different Clocky puzzles I've already solved. And I'll do something a little, let's go back to the really early days. I'm sorry, if you're epileptic, please turn your head away from the TV.
This is very Monument Valley-ish.
Yeah, and I don't know, is there music? Because I guess there must be. Oh, yeah, it is very much. So I'm going way back to the beginning. Because I don't want to challenge you with something that's too hard.
No, please don't.
Wow, did I go back to the
I'm exhausted
the
by whooping.
Now? Yeah, let's start with that. So, no instructions, no rules. You really don't know what you're up to here. That's why you want to start kind of at the beginning.
Calming music, that's good.
I'm sorry about this. I should have rewound. Okay, now these are pretty easy. Okay. So, in fact, I think this is the first one here. Yeah. So, this is that game. When you launch Clocky, this is where you're going to start. You see, it's a lot less complicated than the one I was on, which is like level 40. And you could just sit here and ponder. And then just try stuff. So tap, okay, something happened. Maybe if I tap again. It rearranged, joins the pieces. So apparently I'm trying to like connect things. Let's go to the next one. What would you do here? Maybe swap these two?
Oh,
no, that didn't work.
That's very satisfying.
So it is satisfying. That's part of the fun of it is actually it's quite satisfying. Well, that's not gonna ever go anywhere. Do you think I can do this? Yeah. So it's very nonverbal, right? Mm-hmm. It you couldn't, if you had to explain to me what I'm doing, I'm not sure I would be able to do that.
Yeah. I try looking at it with one eye, if that helps, but
no,
it's not
I don't,
really helping.
You know, I don't know. So you just keep doing things until... Is that satisfying?
Yes. It's very Tetris-like.
Yeah. So you're really, you're swapping tiles. It actually gets a lot more complicated as I go down the road. You'll see there's more than just swapping. There's rotating. There's all sorts of complicated things. And topographically, it gets very, very difficult as it goes on. But it's still kind of, there's no clock. You can look at it. You can even, frankly, do trial and error. In fact, a lot of what I ended up doing was just, well, let me just keep trying this till something makes sense, you know? I'm sure this will make sense. Eventually, you figure out, well, you can't mix the horizontal with the vertical. That's not going anywhere. How could I solve? Oh, wait a minute. I've got to get these over here, right? Because then, and then I got to get some more vertical stuff over here. Maybe I'll mix this with,
Does it let you do a move that is going to mess you up later?
Yes.
Like at the Rubik's Cube?
Yes. There's no guarantees in life or in Clocky.
Mm.
How about that? That's a good move. So, but, what I kind of like is I still can't really explain what I'm doing. But eventually things click. And when they click, it's very satisfying. This is Clocky, K-L-O-C-K-I. There's several of them. Get the one with the quotes. It's by Mash. It's a very hard name to pronounce. Maciej, I don't know, M-A-C-I-E-J. It's a Polish name, and I can't remember the last name. But if you search for, quote, Clocky, quote, it's an iPad or iPhone app. And I really, it's very satisfying, right? Now, we'll go real quickly. We'll see if we can, you see it gets harder and harder and harder.
How much is this app?
I think it's free. I don't know. Can you check, Brian? Because once you bought it, this always bothers me. You can't go back to the store and find out how much it costs. I don't think it was very expensive. This is not, you know, somebody's in the chat saying, well, I have things to do in life. Of course. So this is not replacing the things you have to do. This is for the times when you're stuck on an airplane. That's it. Maciej Targoni, and it's 99 cents. Thank you, Chickenhead 21.
99 cents.
And well worth it. I see it's getting very complicated. These rotate. There's different colored lines. Pretty soon you're going to start to realize, there's a certain way things are going to go. This one, by the way, took me a long time to figure out. And I don't even remember the solution. It was complicated. Now we've got these things. we rotate. Ay, 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 caramba. It gets very, you can see it gets very crazy. And they combine these. This is the one I'm currently on. Probably stuck on, although I don't remember. So look at this. Yeah, this is Monument Valley, isn't it?
Yeah.
At this point. Because it's topography.
Right.
Some things can't move. Some things can. This is ridiculous. Oh, clocky, ladies and gentlemen. It's really 99 cents. It's well worth it. There it is.
Mm-hmm.
And, but it's hard to find because apparently there's a game, a block, sliding block game. I've played it. I didn't realize it was called Clocky. But look for the one with quotes.
Quotes.
By Mashej.
Targoni.
Targoni. 99 cents.
All right. That's all we got. You did a really great job today, I have to say.
I didn't offend you?
No. That's not what I was thinking.
That's
but you
my
had
goal.
Some great moving apps. I think we all learned something today. Yes.
To dream the impossible dream.
So next week we'll be in a new place. We'll have used all our apps. Mops.
Golly!
And yeah. So we'll be here next week. We'll be there next week.
This
we'll
is our somewhere. Last show from the Brick House Studio unless don't move. There's a small chance.
Doesn't quite look ready for us.
That whatever's going on there will not be done, in which case we'll just stay here.
Well, that's what I said last week. I don't want to go anywhere. I'm happy to stay here.
I don't want to go anywhere either, but it's going to be hard to keep doing the shows once they start moving in the big vats for brewing beer.
I think it will actually be easier to do the show once they start moving the vats.
Forget
the
Diet
beer.
Coke. How do I stop drinking all that beer?
Yes. All right, well, if you have suggestions, if you have criticisms, comments, anything, email me, megan@twit.tv, or email Leo, and he might also.
I don't know an email.
He doesn't know how to email him.
You'd be crazy at this point.
You'd be crazy.
And I'll never see it.
Yeah. Oh, but you can tweet at us. You can tweet at me. I'm
nope,
at Megan Maroney.
Tweet at me. I don't even
look at
Twitter.
I'll read it
anymore.
To him, so.
I feel like social networking is over for me. I don't want
to
do
okay.
it.
It's okay. You don't have to. You do
in
not
fact,
have to.
I'm slowly withdrawing into my shell. Can you tell?
All right. This might be the last time you see him ever. So say goodbye to everybody.
Goodbye, everybody. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time. We can still do this on iOS Today.